This is Slam Pigs Podcast.
Welcome back, Slam Pigs Podcast number 75.
Woo!
We're back here, not live this week, going old school on it. Once again, Michael, welcome back to Slam Pigs Podcast. How was your week? What's going on? Where can everyone check you out on Twitter? All that good stuff.
Week has been long, rainy, and there's been a lot of drama this week, Travis. But overall, I'm still doing all right. But as always, check me out at Mike the Slam Pig on Twitter. Check us out at the Hibiki TMD. As always, check out the sister show, The Reset Button. Check out Future of Wrestling Podcast with Logan and his new co-host, Broski.
Look at that. And Logan, doing you proud. Got a trick up his sleeve with Future Wrestling. I'm happy for
also
Logan.
Also, 205 Live, the Cruise Control
Logan
show.
Logan has not stepped back. He's still, we're trudging through 205
Don't forget
Live.
Slam Tits is
and
on that as
slam
well.
Slam Tits!
That's right.
Your favorite line. It took from me this week.
That's right.
But yeah, check out.
She's a doll,
shows.
Baby.
Unfortunately, guys, no more Union Smack, but it is what it is. You know, we got a million
we'll
fucking
to
shows. We got a million shows anyway.
Is that where you want to start, Travis? Do you need to get something off your chest?
I don't need to get anything off my chest.
Well, I need to get something off my chest about it.
I mean, if you feel it necessary, who am I to people are expecting you to say something, so what am I even thinking? So, Michael, but before we get there, can I whore myself out?
Go ahead.
You whore
it. Pay some bills.
Follow me on Twitter at the Hibiki TMD and everything else Michael said about the shows. Like we said, Union Smack, it is, I will say it was fun to do with Matt.
Yes.
It had become one of my more favorite things to do. Unfortunately, when the grass keeps getting taller, the snakes are harder to find. And apparently, it is what it is. We can't be like civilized adults and be men about this. Even when approached about anything, you get blocked. You get just... shit. I mean, I'm not gonna beat around the bush.
I got blocked. Did you get blocked?
I sure did.
Okay.
Unfortunately, we're talking about Matt Tennant from Union Smack the Ghost. Some drama went down. We're not gonna get too into it. Gonna try to remain a little civilized about it and take the higher road.
Fuck that.
Well,
this is a Slam Pigs. This is a Slam Pigs podcast. I don't have to be fucking civilized. I'm gonna speak my opinion on this bullshit. When I don't know how they do things over there in England, and I'm not gonna take it there to just insult a whole country, but where I come from, you have a problem with a man, you say it to him. You don't go and be like a little girl and talk to somebody else about it and say, don't say anything because I don't want to get in trouble.
The reason this is even being brought up, because I know that's become one of the most viewed and popular things on this channel. We don't get a lot of views as it is, but when we get them, we cherish them, and I'm sorry to people like Jay Baca and people that really like that show. Trust me, I'd like it probably even more than you guys. But it is no more. But hey, you got Cruise Control. You got Mike starting a channel. Look at that.
Right.
Mike is
Mike the Slam Pig is branching out.
If you can't get enough of me, even though you guys, you know, you make fun of me for doing 15,000 podcasts and game reviews, I'm also on Kayfabe Today, which just dropped yesterday.
Right.
But I'm ecstatic, man. Old school styling without, by the way, twice last week, YouTube fucked us in the ass. They got us on Cruise Control and they got us on the main OG Slam Pigs, cutting like an hour and a half off last week's episode. We still got an hour in on the Battleground, but still apologies. We had our buddy James Hebert came on. He totally got cut out from YouTube, but I know you guys are digging the live stuff and the live chat. We were too, but it's not worth not getting everything we're putting our work into to get out. So we're just going to stick
to
this format, see how it goes, and maybe, you know, the post shows we're going to keep doing live. Yeah. So,
but Travis, I believe I'm going to go ahead and segue you to your favorite part of all of our episodes. I think it's time.
Well, we've gotten all of our grievances aired, and without further ado, it's time for this week's Raw Review. Monday Night Raw was live this week. Michael... I don't know why I say that every week. It's always live. I always say, well, bad habit. But it was, and you know what? I'm going to say right off the bat, not as good as SmackDown this week. The show was boring as hell for the most part. A few bright spots, but for the most part...
We're going to have our first disagreements there.
I enjoyed SmackDown more.
Huh.
Go ahead.
All right. Well, Raw was live this week. It opened up with Kurt Angle, I believe, out in the center of the ring. Is that correct? He was out there to start the show to address the WWE Universal Championship picture.
Yep.
Travis, what went on?
I mean, pretty much it's rinse and repeat what we've been seeing with the, you know, the Roman intensity mixed with the Joe, all of the guys. This one just had Braun Strowman thrown in. And yeah, I mean, besides Braun launching that security guy, by the way, hell of a bump, as we all saw.
I think we all predicted this. We predicted it last week on our show.
Match is going to be, they took the most four intense guys in the company and they put them all in one match.
Yes, which I will watch that show solely for that match, if not for anything else. Because I think this is a great idea on their part. It's a great way. I feel like there's no way Brock Lesnar retains here. I feel like this is the best way to get the belt off of him without him looking weak. I could see any of the other three guys winning the belt here. Obviously, for those who don't know, Fatal 4-Way match for the Universal title has been officially made.
So there's a Raw main event?
Yes, it will be Brock Lesnar defending against Samoa Joe, Roman Reigns, and Braun. Yeah, did you see the new shirt came out for Braun?
I did.
Yes,
I was asked. I want it. I've already made my predictions on that match and booked it on kayfabe yesterday because he had a fan question. But we're going to save our prediction on that booking of that match. But I've got a good way they can do it, and nobody comes out looking weak. I don't know about you, but
all right.
Can we talk about the worst thing on the show this week and get it out of the way first?
Go ahead.
Because I feel like nobody's bitching about this one this week. Am I the only one that saw the Sonic Pretzel commercial tied in with the Hardy's Bailey promo? And it was weird, and it was, felt like the biggest waste of time besides, like, Rusev and Cena this year.
I did not see it.
This was awful. Avoid this at all costs. I just
Sonic
wanted to...
Pretzels, huh?
Yeah.
I thought they just did chili cheese dogs and tater tots.
No, pretzel dogs or something like that. But, yeah. I hate when big commercials are thrown in my wrestling. To be sly about it like they used to do sometimes back in the day, that's maybe gets a pass. It just,
but they need that money. They came out with their second quarter report this past week.
Yeah.
WWE, for those who don't know, posted their second quarter report on all of their profits and losses. My biggest issue is the network. They've cut so much on the network.
Yep.
And they just basically keep the same number of subscribers solely based on people
getting the pay-per-views.
Yes, getting the pay-per-views and then unsubscribing. And then doing it all over again on pay-per-views that they want. Because they've cut so much content, original content, like shows that I enjoy, from the network. Which makes it almost, I don't know, not as fun to get on the network. I know Vince is trying to cut costs. I mean, I know we've gone over that they have cut Pyro and things of that nature, which has saved them a lot of money.
Yeah.
But still, is it good for wrestling, Travis, to basically get so nitpicky about your funds?
I would
when you're the only one powerhouse in the world in professional wrestling.
I would rather them take Pyro away than to make every set look the same.
They even took smoke away. They even took the fog machines out.
That's ridiculous.
Like, how is
God Undertaker retired, because there goes half
I mean, centers. Becky Lynch gets nothing now.
Yeah.
So
it is weird to see people like Neville and Becky Lynch now. We'll get used to it, I'm sure, but we always do with change of wrestling.
I think they're going to do that with Finn Balor when he does his Demon King thing?
I would say, as far as the money, one of the worst things that happened to them was as soon as the network started 3 years ago. You notice how, like, back in the day, Unforgiven sets would look totally different. You could tell.
Yeah.
But now they're all the Raw sets.
Yes.
Because that's,
unless it's SummerSlam or the Rumble or
if I had to choose, I would rather have a set design than Pyro. I would
Costs
rather...
more money.
I know. But you take the money you cut from the Pyro and put that into your sets from what you already had, and bada boom, bada bing.
That would be a legitimate and reasonable way to do things.
WCW, their Halloween Havoc, it was like cardboard. They made the shit.
Yeah.
It was cheap. Like, the tombstones are made out of cardboard, and, like, they painted them.
Yeah.
It didn't take, like, those were awesome sets.
But still, it didn't look terrible.
Exactly.
So, I mean,
some of the best sets ever.
You can do things.
Bash at the Beach set was like a boardwalk. Yes. Nasty Boys had a brawl with like the beach toys and stuff.
I like the old school Royal Rumble where they had the road that went to the ring because it's the road to WrestleMania.
Yeah.
I think they only did that one time.
It's
I
a
thought
nice
that
touch.
Was a great idea.
It's a nice touch.
But also, Travis, we'll get into some news later.
We will.
But my biggest issue.
This is go ahead.
Go ahead.
Well, I was going to say this is kind of newsworthy as while we'll get to the news and we'll stay on Raw. Nia Jax squashed the shit out of Emma this week. Now, a lot of people are saying the tweets from last week that we talked about with Emma complaining about it being her anniversary and having nothing to do. And she mysteriously pops up the next week. I don't know. I'm going to ask you, I guess, off the bat. Do you think this is real life imitating art? Or do you think the whole thing, because this is the quote-unquote reality era, this is a way we talk about, do you use social media for good? Use it for an angle. Get people to believe it more. Because if people see it on Twitter, they always believe it more now in this day and age.
Well, yeah, I think it...
What do you think it is?
I actually think it helps Emma more than it hurts her. And I might be against the grain here on a lot of people thinking it's going to hurt
her. If it's a work, it helps her? Or do you think it's a shoot,
Regardless, I think it still helps her. Because WWE does take a lot of stock into their social media nowadays.
They got eyes on her.
Yes. And regardless of what you're doing on television, if you're on television, it's a good thing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Whether you're getting squashed by Nia Jax or whatever, at least you're on television, okay? And we all know, I think nobody's ever had a problem with Emma's in-ring ability.
Yeah. No, she's really good.
I mean, maybe especially for
men. Because her promos are flat out awful.
In-ring ability, I'm talking here.
Yeah.
I think we saw it in NXT with her matches with Paige and among others. Emma is a spectacular worker. I would definitely put her... And a lot of people might disagree with me. I put her top five in the company.
When she's allowed to be.
Yeah.
It seems like they've
You give her some time. You give her some time to actually get over a little bit.
Yeah.
This girl can fucking work.
People forget about they used to praise her years ago in her matches with Paige in NXT.
Yes. Those were the most talked about matches. They were awesome matches
for the women.
That's right. I mean,
that's
like,
before Charlotte broke through any of that stuff.
Yes. And I feel like she doesn't get enough credit for that because that was back when NXT wasn't as
infancy. It was just breaking onto the network. Like
and
the first
her and Paige put
special.
On some fucking classics.
Yeah, it was actually at the first takeover special.
Yes, they fought for the belt.
Yep.
And I feel like this girl has a lot of potential. But what we are in the era right now, I feel like, of people that are so over because of in-ring ability and charisma and microphone skills are not as valued as they once were. So why is this girl
exactly?
Why is this girl being left out? Because it's
is
hard
that
for me
why
to find.
It's maybe leading you to think it's not a work, or it is a. I'm sorry, it's not a work. Like she was shooting with that.
Yeah,
tweet.
I think she was shooting with that tweet. Yeah. To be honest with you, and it's easy to understand why. I know that my biggest issue with Emma is her character. She has nothing with her character that makes me want to get invested. I feel like she may need, once again, the 50th fucking time, she needs a character redevelopment.
I'm going to say, like our buddy Broski, he's all about the evil Emma gimmick.
I loved her with Dana Brooke in NXT. I thought that was a great gimmick.
It was okay. I don't think I've ever been in love with an Emma character. I think for me, like you said, I hated her dancing. Dana Brooke was there for me for once, so that killed most of it. I just, her in-ring for her, you know, that gets
She's
me.
She's so talented. Why is Natalya so valued as an in-ring performer?
Lana, I mean,
And I know Natalya is pound for pound maybe the best female wrestler in the company.
Maybe.
But
maybe. At
what
this stage of the game,
what
maybe.
Does she do for you?
Because we're going to get to it here in a little bit. Bayley and Sasha had a hell of a fucking match this week.
Yes.
Hell of a match.
Well, of course you knew they were going to.
Well, they were.
If they were given time, you knew they were going to put on a good match.
We're going to get to that, guys. But having no fear, we are going to give credit where it's due as much as we shit on Bayley. Man, that was a great match this week. But right here with the Emma thing, I personally think it's not a work. I think it was just her lashing out on Twitter. And I can see them being this petty to punish someone on air like this because they've done it in the past. So you totally have reason to think they would because they've done it.
But the funny thing is they think they're punishing her, but she's on television.
But
I think she's an old school thinker.
If it gets her over, it's another case of like a Steve Austin back in the day.
Give Emma a chance.
Steve Austin didn't get noticed until he started complaining about Bischoff and ECW. And it totally, so we'll see.
You think maybe down the line we could see an Emma pipe bomb?
Does she have the charisma to pull that off?
You don't have to have charisma to just speak your feelings.
Because the only two pipe bombs we've seen, quote unquote, in this era were AJ Lee and CM Punk. And for what it's worth, the argument, arguably, the two most charismatic men and women that we've seen in the last 10 years.
Yes, because
maybe.
They were allowed to speak their minds.
Right.
I don't think it was them playing a character. I think it was them actually addressing their issues.
We never knew that Neville had this inside of me there at the same time.
I think when you're allowed to be yourself and you can address your issues, I feel like that's going to make you more admirable to the WWE fans.
Yeah.
I don't like saying WWE Universe.
No, we won't.
I hate it.
Yeah.
So I call them the WWE fans. I think when you come out and you can be real with us, it makes us want to invest in your character, whatever it is. If you can come out and say, you know what, I'm sick of this fucking shit, in a certain way that's PG, that makes me go, wow.
Yeah.
All right. I didn't know they had that in them.
The baby
that's
faces.
What happened with CM Punk. Did anybody really have a whole lot of stock invested in CM Punk before he did the fight?
He was floundering in, like, the Straight Edge Society. Yes. And then they made him the leader of fucking Nexus for some reason, and it made no sense.
Nobody had...
It kind of did, I guess, but they just handled it wrong. And you could tell he was phoning in his matches by then. And then it was like, poof, that.
You're like, wow, I didn't know this guy had that in him. I'm invested. Yeah. I feel like if WWE could capitalize on that a little more without it being too cliche...
Yeah.
I feel like it would do them wonders with people like Emma. If Emma was allowed to, after, if she got squashed by Nia Jax and then after the match fucking got on the microphone and just lashed out.
Is it too soon to do that week one, or would that have been perfect timing?
I feel like with the big social media thing in the world right now, I feel like it would have been a perfect time to do it. But still, I think there's miles there to where if they really want to, they could keep having her get squashed by people and then finally do it. And I feel like they could make another star there just by her being herself. If she's anything like her Twitter, I feel like you could make another star there. And what's wrong with that these days? I know their roster's huge, but what's wrong with making more stars? Nothing. I don't see anything wrong with that.
As long as the stars are entertaining.
Exactly, especially if they have the ability in the ring. And now, if you're going to make a star out of somebody that's mediocre at best in the ring, I don't see the point.
Let's kind of segue this onto another part of Raw that's kind of what you're talking about, but like the complete opposite. Giving the promo time someone to be themselves that isn't ready, it shouldn't have a mic. Akira Tozawa got an in-ring interview segment this week. You know what? And the very next night, we talked about on Cruise Control this week, they put him on color commentary, and it was awful each time. And this is going to sound bad, but sometimes, God forbid, we take a guy who can't speak English, keep him off mic. Just let him do stuff in the ring.
Give him a fucking... Why couldn't Titus speak for him?
Give him a ring.
It was so much...
Give him a professional wrestling ring to entertain.
They were doing fine with Titus speaking for him.
Oh.
They were doing fine with that. And now they try to give him a microphone. It's just awful. It would be the same way.
Here's one for you.
It would be the same way. The perfect example of how to handle somebody the right way.
Yeah.
Brock Lesnar.
Exactly. Any fucking mid card heel from the 80s, Hercules, Barbarian, they had Bobby Heenan, Jimmy Hart, guys like that.
A mouthpiece.
Exactly.
Now, so, Brock Lesnar speaks English, you know, fine.
Yeah.
But does anybody want to listen to Brock Lesnar on a microphone?
But if anything, did you see the Cruiserweight segment? It was Ari Daivari actually coming out looking strong, attacking Neville and Tozawa?
Mm-hmm.
That transitioned into like a DQ schmoz finish the next night on 205 with Neville and Daivari as heel versus heel. What did you think about that segment on Raw? As kind of, I know, guys, I'm not supposed to like him because he's a heel, but like I said on Cruise Control, he's boring as fucking paint. I'm just not about really any Daivari. I never have been.
I don't like Daivari, to be honest with you.
He does nothing for me.
Yeah, I don't understand why he's getting this opportunity, to be honest with you.
And that hairline.
I don't feel like he's... My thing is, it has nothing to do with his character. It has to do with him being interesting.
Not jumping off the screen kind of thing.
Yeah, there's nothing about this guy that says, oh, well, let's put him in our main event picture. Yeah. I feel like there's creative writers that, okay, who haven't we pushed yet in the cruiserweight division? All right, let's give him the next shot.
He's left.
Yes, I feel like they did the same thing with Tozawa.
Hey, you.
Tozawa was, who's next on the list?
I think Tozawa was more, they're so desperate, they just saw that that fucking weird chant got over, and they just...
I mean, you're coming up on the second biggest pay-per-view of the year.
And Cedric's
nowhere
near the title.
Alexander doing?
You know, everyone's saying it. We'll just be those guys too, I guess, and jump in.
I mean,
it should be Cedric right now.
It's ridiculous. I mean, this is why 205 Live.
But no, we're too busy putting Cedric in an irrelevant tag match in the main event of 205 Live with fucking Red Swan against Tony Nese and TJP. To continue
another guy. Tony Nese.
Yeah.
What the fuck have they done with it?
The only reason that tag match happened yesterday was to progress the Rich Swan TJP feud. Yeah. Nothing for Cedric in that. He was there.
Or Tony Nese.
He did some elbows.
If I was Tony Nese, I would be so pissed.
Well,
like, because
Tony Nese is playing it safe. He's not a politician. He's happy to be there. A lot of these guys are happy to be there.
Yes, but Tony Nese, for those who know him before he was in WWE.
But say what you want. I know you're a big Nese guy. He's not the best on the mic. He's really not.
He doesn't have to be as a heel.
And he looks like Neville. Just like fucking Neville. No matter how many fluorescent undies you put on him, I see Neville. I'm sorry.
I don't see Neville. I don't see giant ears.
He needs to differentiate himself. Just like Mike Bennett. A lot of these guys, Oney Lorcan, shave your fucking beard off. Look what it's doing for Drew Gulak. Drew Gulak looked just like Oney Lorcan when he came in. He stands out. And you could say he's
still not getting a push.
You can say Gulak sets your world on fire or not. They're not pushing him, but still, he stands out at the end of the day to you out of all those guys on 205.5.
He's a heel.
Because everybody has a fucking hipster beard now. And I hate to say it. Sorry, love you, broski. Everybody has a fucking hipster beard. In pro wrestling, it's not even about that. But at the end of the day, all these guys look carbon copies of each other facially. Mike Bennett, in that gimmick, isn't supposed to be this grizzly fucking man bun guy. It's supposed to be this arrogant Dolph Ziggler fucking Shawn Michaels 92 baby face. Or heel, excuse me. I'm all over the place. It's been a week, like you said, with bullshit and drama.
We'll get there on SmackDown. We'll get there.
Jason Jordan. We're not through the shit yet. Got his nepotism at its finest, Michael, against fucking Curt Hawkins. How well did this work out for Eric Watts? How well, even if we'll pretend kayfabe doesn't even matter, because it doesn't matter if it's kayfabe or not. If you're booking a storyline where the booker's son is an active member on the roster, booking at favoritism against a jobber where...
I hope they're trying to book him as a heel.
That's where I see it going. It's so predictable that he's going to turn heel on Kurt for that you were never there for me. Or the other way around. There's going
to
be a fucking
The difference turn. In that is I don't feel like they have to. I feel like the fans are going to shit on it naturally.
Yeah, I mean, we saw no reaction.
We see through it.
And they also had to sit down.
You're Kurt's son, and you were in a tag team, but magically you're on Raw, and you're going to get this big singles push.
They had an extension of the after Raw last week on the
which
network,
I think is going to lead. Interview. Which I think is going to lead to later down the road the big picture of Kurt Angle versus whomever, whether it's Triple H or whatever. So basically, what's going to happen is Triple H is going to get booked as a babyface, probably in this.
I don't get it.
And I don't understand that. I don't know where they're going with this.
Guys,
this is the one thing they're doing in WWE that I have no fucking idea what you're thinking.
You just see his
None.
Face. He just threw his hands
What
in
the
air.
Fuck are you doing?
They're thinning.
Like, Kurt Angle got this big response coming back. He's got all this momentum behind him, and you're basically making him into this guy who's going to promote his son.
You mean like they did with Mick Foley? Yes. The guy right before this? They did the same thing with Foley.
Foley still got over as a babyface. Making Kurt Angle down the line look like the heel.
Is it sad that neither Foley or Kurt or anything like themselves either on the mic anymore? WWE and my teeth keep falling out for Mick Foley.
Yeah, it's just...
And stepping over his line. Mick Foley was getting awful on the mic. And I thought I would never say that about that man. One of my top five fucking promos of all time is Mick Foley. Bottom line, maybe top three for sure, but it is what it is. We got to move the train along, greener pastures. I mean, but
let us know in the comment section below what you think of this whole angle with Kurt Angle.
Have you
and
given
Jason
up
Jordan?
Like I have?
Does
week one
anybody
in?
Fucking give a shit?
I gave it a chance. I gave him one.
I
week.
I did too. But
and
does
they
anybody
went nepotism.
Give a shit?
Yes. They went nepotism. They did Greg Gagne. They did Eric Watts. They did that. My daddy's the fucking booker.
You could have picked anybody. My biggest issue here.
And then you have Emma in a promo saying, oh, I want to fucking bang your son to get a push, basically.
Yes. It just,
what a wonders that does for her character.
My biggest issue here is nobody. The biggest issue with Jason Jordan in NXT was nobody wanted to watch him as a singles wrestler.
Exactly.
So you put him in a tag team that gets over. You bring him up on the main roster as the tag team, and they get over a little bit. You take him off the goddamn camera, and then you break him up. So now we're going to go, oh, we're going to put Jason Jordan as a singles guy who couldn't get over in NXT, but we're going to get him over on the main roster. Are you fucking kidding me?
I didn't do it.
Jesus.
Stop. I have to call him Easy Jim. Easy Jim Neidhart.
Who the fuck's writing this shit?
A lot of people don't remember Jason Jordan was an enhancement talent guy in NXT, and he was vanilla as shit. I don't know.
But I'm sorry, but
so good happened.
Jesus Christ.
I really wish this show, and you're wondering why I said SmackDown was a better show, because we go right into Enzo Amore squat, or excuse me.
The fuck is Jason Jordan doing in a singles run?
We're moving the train along and calm me down. Big Cass squash Enzo again in pretty much the same fashion. Did a great Balls of Fire. Big Show came out to save the day. Is it time to just already get Big Show out of the fucking picture?
That's not a good way to fucking calm me down either.
It's not,
is wrong with WWE? You have a big, adorable, well, I'm sorry,
adorable?
Little.
Is he the big doll baby of the week?
Enzo has been the big doll baby of the month.
Who said
how many times do you have to squash this guy before you realize this guy is main event talent? Train him in the ring. The crowd is behind
Did
him.
Did you say he was adorable? You said that.
He's little.
Did you mean to say that?
Yeah, I meant to.
What?
He's adorable. Does the crowd not adore him?
Oh, so you're going to twist it in that kind of like it's
adorable in its meaning.
I thought you meant cute as a button type adorable.
No, not like that I want to fuck him
like
or anything. No.
The snuggle bear.
No.
The laundry bear.
This guy has sympathy out the fucking asshole. And he's still getting squashed. When are they going to pull the trigger on this guy? I know he's not the greatest in-ring talent, but...
I don't think I've ever... Wait, I got to stop. I don't think I've ever heard anyone be called adorable so angrily in my life.
Well, I'm just wondering.
Jesus Christ.
I'm already pissed off about Jason Jordan.
It's just Jason Jordan. It's not like it's the WWE title picture. I mean...
He's getting... You know what they're doing with him at SummerSlam.
But at least Alpha will be back by the winter, hopefully, if this shits the bed. They would have to think the Chad... We'll get to Chad Gable, but... The Enzo stuff, I mean, I gotta agree with Michael. I don't think it's a good way to... I mean, they could keep the Enzo storyline going now, but... I don't even think... I mean, people say it a lot. Other shows...
How are we ever gonna take this guy credible?
We don't mean to sound like all the other fucking shows you guys listen to, but yeah, it's... Kids don't even care about Big Show right now. He's in such an irrelevant stage... He's beyond even being a special attraction, because with special attractions...
That's not even my issue.
Do you know what makes something a special attraction? People want to see him!
Yeah.
People want to invest in seeing that! Nobody wants to see the Big Show. None. They don't.
None. Unless he's going against Shaq.
But, you know...
And the only reason people would want to see that is because people that don't watch wrestling are like, oh, Shaq's going to wrestle? Who's he going to wrestle? Oh, he's going to wrestle somebody his size?
Exactly.
Holy shit!
Now, imagine the hype if they would take Strowman and Shaq. It'd be so much bigger than the Big Shows.
Do that to Strowman.
Here's something I've actually been wanting to get your thoughts on all week since I saw this match. It seems like babyface Gallows and Anderson went up against the Revival here, and a lot of people were predicting they're going to bring the Balor Club together, the dirt sheets are speculation, Wyatt Family versus Balor Club. People are calling bullshit, it's not confirmed. I'd rather see the Balor...
How do you feel about the Good Brothers turning face?
No, I'd rather see him as heels. I'd rather see Balor Club as heels. And I don't think the Wyatt...
You want to see your Finn Balor as a heel?
Why can't they just be two heel factions going out? Like, when the Shield and the Wyatt Family did that, it was tremendous.
Because they put all this time and effort in making Finn Balor babyface.
It's they just can't say, poof, you're a heel like that, you think? Or
they could, but how much time can you really invest in a heel that's 190 pounds?
I mean, if they're waiting like...
That's leading a faction of two guys that are bigger than him.
Look at it this way. If they're waiting 3 weeks only at SummerSlam, that's not a lot of time. They're going to try to cram in Luke Gallows and Carl Anderson explaining why they're turning face, along with coming it all together with bringing Harper and Rowan back, all that shit within 3 weeks. They could probably do it, but it's going to come off rushed, and it's not going to be the time spent to it.
I'm hoping it doesn't get rushed to SummerSlam. I'm hoping that's one of those angles that gets pushed back.
What do you think about this? What do you think of them as babyfaces? Would you rather see that or no? Just keep them heel.
My biggest problem, I know it's been done successfully before, is if Finn Balor is involved. It's just hard to get behind or believe in a heel that's so little.
He was, but that's the thing. When Bullet Club was probably my favorite incarnation, was him as the leader as heels in Japan. And he is capable of being like that little... Because especially with like the big guys like that to surround him.
I mean, I could see
it makes him a better heel. You know what I mean?
I can see the chicken shit gimmick with him, but his in-ring style is not chicken shit.
Yeah. I mean, neither is Neville's, but he's doing all right with that.
Yeah, balance, but he's in the cruiserweight division where he's big. You know, if you put him on the main roster as a heel,
he's still really short.
He's going to flounder. Yes, he's going to look little. He's not going to be able to use that moveset. The same thing, he looks like a heel on 205 Live because he can overpower people.
Yeah.
Finn Balor is never going to look like that.
And that's why I say him and Tony Nese. His
in-ring style, as far as Finn Balor goes, is that quick-paced, high-flyer type style, and I just don't know how well it could get over in WWE as a heel. That's my biggest problem. The Good Brothers club hold the mayo on this show.
Club hold the heel?
I think they're better as heels as well, but I think they would need a better leader. I think I know it's already been done with Finn Balor, but...
Not Styles, because they've already tried that.
Yes.
And they didn't handle that well, I don't think.
But I could see them with a different guy. I mean, you could make Corbin. A case. You could make a case for
shake
that.
Up.
Yeah, you could make a case for that. I wouldn't bring back the Bullet Club, but I would put them in a faction, maybe with a top guy. And I'm not going to mention names.
Randy Orton.
But a top guy.
Randy Orton. Scott Dawson. Top guys.
There you go.
Scott Dawson and Gallows and Anderson. There's your dream stable.
But I'm just saying, you put them, like when Triple H did it with Randy Orton and Batista. I know that Gallows and Anderson are much more accomplished.
Yeah.
But if you put them with a upper echelon main event guy, that's a heel.
Bodyguards, thugs for Triple
yes,
H.
Yes, you could like what The Miz is doing with Axel and
should have been Gallows and Anderson with The Miz.
Could have been.
Are you
been.
Digging this?
Could have been. I would have liked it. To be honest with you, I would have bought into it.
Yeah.
But you know, I see them with a top guy, not just a guy that's in the main event picture. I could see them with Roman Reigns if they turned him heel. To be honest with you,
I think the Usos obviously.
Well, it's yeah, family. But they're on separate shows.
Yeah,
but. I could see them with a guy like that. I could see them with a guy like that.
Yeah.
I could see them with Paul Heyman and Brock Lesnar, to be honest with you. I could see them with a top guy as their hired
Heyman
muscle.
Team.
Yes.
Heyman team.
The Heyman hustle team, whatever you want to call it. But I like that stuff. If I was going to put the club Hold the Mayo in a faction, it would be with an actual top guy right now. One of the established guys in WWE.
Not Balor. Yes. And Elias Sampson, did you see that this week in the news?
He's just, Elias.
He's just Elias now. Yes. What do you think about the name change for him?
I'm waiting for JoJo to fuck it up. Ladies and gentlemen, Elias Sampson. And Vince on the fucking back going, what the fuck? You know, it's, you know.
I told her it was Elias.
It's just Elias.
Well, you have a week? Did you say it so she fucks
ladies,
it up?
Ladies and gentlemen, Elias. I do like the Walk with Elias gimmick. I like it.
Is it being overdone? And yet again this week.
It should be overdone. It's supposed to be disliked.
Finn Balor and Elias Sampson, no DQ match. Obviously, like we said, broken up by Bray Wyatt. Elias Sampson, hot off of that guitar shot and stuff.
He gets to win.
He does here with the distraction.
So my biggest issue here is...
Is this going to continue for another 6 months?
This is the first feud that Finn Balor has lost. I think the miles are done with this feud.
Do you think it's...
What do you do with Elias Sampson? He's won this feud with Finn Balor. Now where do you put him? That's my biggest issue.
Christ.
That's my biggest issue. What do you do with Elias Sampson now?
You have him go against Jason Jordan? I don't know.
In a number one contenders match against him for the winner.
Probably what they'll do next.
Yes, that's probably what's going to happen next week on Raw for the number one contender shot at The Miz at SummerSlam, because we all know Jason Jordan is going to get that Intercontinental.
Could you imagine once they finally separate Enzo and Cass, Enzo comes out for that promo in ring, all of a sudden you hear a guitar strum. Then they do it, for some reason, Elias and Enzo. It's kind of a built-in feud because they're so different. They like hip-hop, one likes rock. I could see that being a feud down the line, like a mid-card bullshit.
Maybe.
It's Elias Sampson, so I'm not really shooting to the moon.
I feel like this feud, which should have done more for Elias Sampson, has actually not helped him at all.
No. Did this help anyone in this? It got Balor injured.
It got Balor to feud with Bray Wyatt, which they teased fucking months ago and got off of, because Bray Wyatt...
They did it for like 1 week, and then they just stopped.
Yep. And then it got switched to Rollins. Yep. So it's like now they're going back to, we should have done this with Finn Balor. But is that a match? Unless Balor and Wyatt can really sell me on this feud with Balor coming out as with Balor coming out as the Demon King.
Is it going to happen in SummerSlam, you think? The Demon King paint? Finally?
How do you do it without any fucking money in the entrance?
You know it's coming.
You just have the Demon King crawling out there with no smoke.
Yeah. You have a bunch of guys sitting around.
What is he, fucking boogeyman?
I got it. Christ. He'll probably be there anyway, because it's one of the big four. He always shows up, one of the legends. Pat Patterson will be out there smoking four cigarettes. Because he always used to hide in the garage smoking cigarettes. Just have him stand on the stage. He'll blend in.
In the Legends house smoking him cigarettes.
The ladies in Raw, Michael, this week, like we said, Bayley and Sasha had the best match I've seen either of these two have, and I feel like fucking months, and that's probably accurate. Honestly,
since Charlotte was on
this reminded me of their NXT days. Really did. And this came as Bayley getting the win out of this. A new number one contender, I believe. A lot of people saying this is predictable for Sasha. I see them doing a 180. I think it's going to be Bayley turning heel. I think they're going to try to do something.
No fucking way.
That's been in the rumor mill.
I think you're smoking too much shit.
I know. It is good shit. But yeah, I can see them doing this, though.
No.
Like, let her hair down, put her in a fucking metal shirt.
No.
Never be Rollins.
No. It's going to be Sasha Banks turning heel, because that's what everybody wants. That's the best Sasha Banks you're going to get. The boss gimmick is the best as a heel, like they did in NXT. That's why she got brought up to the main roster, not to be a babyface.
What did you think of this match?
It was a great match. I actually did get a chance to watch this match. I enjoyed it. I love the facial expression from Sasha after the match, which was why I think she's going to lead to be a heel.
Do you think the heel turns right around the corner? And
yes,
think,
I feel like it's at SummerSlam.
Do you think it's too soon to have Bayley right back in the title picture after that sit-down interview?
I feel like it's going to make sense after Sasha costs her the championship.
Think they're going to bring it. They're finally going to do something right with the women.
That's going to lead to an actual secondary feud in the women's division.
Holy shit. Cue the Shawn Michaels and Triple H.
Holy shit. It's not just one feud for the title. Yeah. You're going to have another feud in the women's division other than the title picture.
It is about time. I mean, SmackDown women have had them forever, and that division, I don't know. Raw obviously has way more. It's deeper talent. It's a deeper roster, in my opinion. I think you would agree.
But yes, a secondary rivalry in a women's division does nothing but help them.
The main event this week in Raw has a lot of controversy behind it. It's all alleged. Nothing's verified. You see this in the news this week. It was Dean Ambrose and Seth Rollins. They've been teasing this Shield bullshit for weeks. I think it's too soon for a Shield reunion. I think you agreed, said. Against the Miztourage. I hate that fucking name. Sorry, I know Broski also loves the Miztourage name. I hate it. I know it makes sense, but it's irritating. Why are you shaking your head?
I have to call him the Miztourage.
It's a Miztourage. Really? Look at some of the chat names you've made today. I just shot an orphan dog.
Why do you always got to give the Miz shit?
I'm giving the creative shit for this terrible name of the stable.
You just won't ever get on board with
the Miz. Actually cut another great promo on Raw Talk this week. I was going to get to that, but you're getting on my shit.
Well, you always give the Miz shit, so I get
sick. I don't always give the Miz shit.
You really do.
Go back.
You hate the Miz, don't you?
Our episodes this year, 2017, 7 months in, I think I've done more than enough praise for the Miz this year than negative. It's always been with the
I think it's because I called him a long time ago, and you were no, he sucks.
You got to hit an agenda there, Sasha?
Well, I'm just saying.
You're paranoid?
Hey, now.
She doesn't listen to wrestling.
Oh, okay, that's good.
And it was a fucking joke. Get over it. Dean Ambrose, not you. Dean Ambrose and Seth Rollins versus the Miztourage. Obviously, the controversy with Dean Ambrose and Rollins winning. After the match, they hugged. Now, the controversy is
they caught some heat for that.
With Triple H, apparently.
They weren't supposed to touch.
I don't know. Do you think that's alleged? Do you think
It's supposed to lead to that fist bump.
That's what Triple H. God, we're gonna have that fist bump.
Yeah. So you pretty much ruined it with hugging each other because a fist bump compared to a hug, I agree, is nothing.
Yeah.
Like if I fist bump you, and we're like yeah, but that's still if you and I hug, I feel like that means more than a fucking fist bump.
I mean, do you think Triple H is that petty? Can you see him being pissed off about that?
He should be pissed off. He's old school.
Do you think they fucked up?
If you're trying to sell...
And they didn't mean to do that?
Yeah, I don't think that was planned.
You think it's a force of habit? Maybe all the house shows they used to do? I mean, they weren't a stable for years, for God's sake.
It could be, but I'm totally on Triple H's side here. If you're trying to sell a story of getting back together, how are you going to sell a story of you guys still aren't friends after you just hugged on television?
It's a lot of times like the opposite kind of like when they're building up a big match.
Yeah.
Even babyface and a heel, we don't like when they touch beforehand, during the build-up. It's not, when they have brawls broken up and they get, a punch in.
If you're trying to sell a gimmick to me where you don't really trust each other, why are you hugging?
Yeah.
That's why Triple H is pissed, which I understand. So they should be getting heat backstage because they pretty much just ruined this whole gimmick of people wanting to see them get back together, and they pretty much just did it on television. But now they're going to keep selling that they don't. They don't really trust each other, even though they just hugged.
Yeah.
So it doesn't make any fucking sense.
And all the Ambrose fans, they always come out and they complain when they hear the rumors about WWE feeling like Ambrose is lazy and blah, blah, blah. If this is true and this is another case of it. I mean, it's not like he's not giving you examples. You see his terrible selling in matches more times than not. You see his...
It's either his psychology. Or oversell.
We have reviewed matches. I feel like time and time again, he'll be in a submission move on his legs and he'll climb the top rope in less than 2 minutes. He does this shit all the time. I don't know if it's out of spite because it's like a punk thing where he's a malcontent. But you can tell that he's probably a bitter guy backstage. Of how he can tell at the end of the day.
Look, he has nobody.
He doesn't seem like a company guy.
Well,
I'm
sorry, but as far as Dean Ambrose goes, you and I used to be... like advocates of give this guy a shot.
Fucking heel. And I think this is going to lead to him turning heel.
This was, I think, a year or 2 years ago. We were both in that contingent of give this guy a chance. And then he got a chance, and we're like, oh, okay, this is why they didn't give him a chance.
Well, it's not that. It's like as soon as they strapped the rocket on him, right? When he got the match with Brock,
it failed.
Is that his fault? I would say a lot of it's yes.
He got the WWE Championship. So, yes, it is his fault.
But also that, the Brock match that you and I, you know.
He got squashed.
Brock didn't want to do anything, but you're still in the match. You could have done something. You still could have done spots where, like, you try to do a big spot and you miss. You still take the bump, but it makes the match more memorable.
Even that, I'm not going to blame it. I'm not going to blame it on the Brock match because he got the WWE Championship after that.
I'm saying that, but I'm saying that's where it kind of started, I feel like, with Ambrose. Because we were hyped for that Brock match at Mania. We reviewed it last year. But then
as much shit as it caught for that match, he still got another rocket put to his asshole and got shot to the top. Where he beats fucking Roman Reigns and Seth Rollins clean at a pay-per-view to regain the championship during the brand split. And it still did not work out because
he didn't beat him. It was Roman and Seth. He didn't beat him.
You can come down to, I'm talking about, he still defended it against both those guys at the next pay-per-view.
Did he?
Right at the brand split, because you had Daniel Bryan and Shane McMahon outside, and then you had Mick Foley and Stephanie McMahon. At the end of the day, he can blame it on whatever he wants. His character is bland. That's what it comes down to.
It's
hard to get behind.
If you go back and you watch him as Jon Moxley, we say this all the time about him, on the indies and CZW, all that stuff, he can't be that same person. And that's the person they signed. That's the backwards mentality of WWE. A Kevin Steen now is not the same Kevin Steen in Ring of Honor. He was a better heel in Ring of Honor because he could do more. These guys based on what they've seen, and when they sign them, they change them. Where's the fucking logic in that?
Does Jon Moxley remind me of Varsity Blues?
It does.
Oh my God, Johnny Moxon.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know who came up with that name, but anybody who's watched Varsity Blues.
But seriously, Jon Moxley, when he was allowed to be that, he was the closest thing to a Pillman I think I had seen any time recently. But
how are you going to pull that off of the PG era?
You can't. We'll see.
His character is bland. That is why he did not work out.
We're bringing something back we haven't done in a while this week. When we come back, we're going to get right into SmackDown Live. But yes, good old-fashioned promo break.
We haven't done it in forever. It's a staple of this show that I feel like...
And I'm going to give it to you as your idea to bring it back.
You're cutting fucking costs on the show. Don't want to do fucking promo breaks anymore.
I cut out a whole fucking UK show to bring back the promo break. See what I did there? That's what WWE should do. Balance their finances.
Fuck the Brits.
I made my loyal employee happy who doesn't talk shit.
It's basically what you're saying.
Fuck the Brits.
Fuck the Brits.
We love the Brits. We love the good ones with spines, usually.
Yeah, the ones that can act like men.
Michael, what's our promo break this week?
I didn't know you were putting me on the spot.
I just said, you brought it back. I'm giving it to you. I thought you would have had one.
I can have one. Give me a couple seconds here. I'm going over what we discussed. I want a Bad News Brown promo right fucking now.
It's been literally like 2 or 3 months since we've done this, and it's going to be Bad News Brown.
Yes, because of the chat today.
No, Hogan was over on the tour, I believe it was like in the early 80s, probably 1980 actually, and you teamed with Hulk on a lot of occasions. What was that like in...
It was good, you know. Hulk was, he was quite the character. I used to like to rib him a lot, you know. And he was something else. So let me go back on the story about Hulk. That incident with the Giant, he was actually sitting in the row behind me. And when I told the bus driver to pull over, and I actually had my earrings in, and I took them out and put them in my bag. Now, I didn't know this later. Hope told me this a couple of days later. He says, "Alan, I'd like to tell you something." And I said, "What is that?" He says, "You know, when I saw you reach out in your bag," he said, "I ducked up under the chairs." And I, "What are you talking about?" He says, "Well," he says, "I never seen nobody talk to Andre like this. I figured this guy's got a gun. He's going to come out. He's going to turn around. He's going to shoot him, look over, see me, and then he's going to shoot me too." I said, "Why did I do that?" He said, "I don't know. Maybe you were mad. You were going to shoot everybody, you know?" And he told me that. I just busted out laughing. I said, "You kidding?" He said, "I swear, man." He says, "I thought you were going to pull a gun out and shoot the guy."
Wow. What was Hulk like back then?
He was a good guy. He was one of the boys. You know, he still didn't have the push that he wound up getting years later. And he was a pretty good guy at that time.
Do you feel he was a better worker back then than he was later years?
Without a doubt. You know, he never was a great worker. He was always a good talker, had charisma up the kazoo. I mean, this guy has unbelievable charisma, but he was never a great worker.
Welcome back, Slam Picks Podcast number 75. Michael, right back here, host Edit City this week. That was Bad News Brown. Mixing it up with the promo breaks and actual
shoot promo.
Hulk Hogan, scared to death of Bad News Brown.
Because he's black.
He didn't say that.
He didn't. I mean, come on.
He didn't say that.
He put his earrings away so he thought the guy was going to get the gun. I never see anybody talk to Andre like that. I figure you had a gun.
Well, why is that, Hawk?
Yeah, because you're black. Well, yeah.
God, that's one of the best things about shoot interviews you can picture in your head while they're telling it.
Yeah.
So that was a good one. That was digging up dirt on the Hulkster and his fear of blacks and guns.
Yeah.
If you're black and you turn around to grab something, it's a gun.
Yeah.
In Hulk's world.
God, he's just like every police officer in the world.
Michael, we are back, Slam Picks Podcast. Let's get right down to the brass tacks. Took your fancy twice this week. It's time for this week's SmackDown Live Review. SmackDown this week started, Michael, with Kevin Owens and AJ Styles in ring.
It was Kevin Owens first.
Yes.
Kevin Owens. About how he's going to bring back the U.S. title challenge, but he was going to do it the following week.
Yep. He hot off the heels of his victory at Battleground, new U.S. champion. This brings out AJ Styles, Michael.
Shocker of the week. Shortly after AJ Styles,
they kept this under wraps. Nobody knew he was coming back already. We knew he'd be back. This is probably a part-time show because Fozzy's probably taking a break. But Chris Jericho, Michael, with
the list,
not just the list. I said it this week in KFA today. Am I the only one that saw the headband on his head that looked like a 12-year-old girl doing a makeup tutorial? What the fuck was that? I still love Jericho, but
or something again.
He's trying. It looks. I don't know. It's a weird place for Jericho right now. It's a weird time in his life.
If you're gonna grow your hair out, at least be like Undertaker. Come back once a year, so you have time.
Put a wig on in your vignettes, and then let it grow the time. Jesus. Michael. Other than that, it was Jericho. It was good to see him.
I liked it. I liked it. I liked the segment.
It's that fucking headband. Yeah. I can't get off of it. Sorry.
You don't like
it. I don't want to see it back. If it comes back next week with lights and shit on it fucking going off, I'm going to lose my shit.
You don't like the Stevie Nicks thing?
Because he's a man. He's not a woman. It just didn't. I don't know. I'll shout out to all you that wear it.
Just like the Wild
Wicked. But this, the announcement made later in the night. Also big news.
If Jericho came out to Stevie Nicks.
I hate you. Also, hot-shotting this episode, the main event was announced. Triple threat match for the U.S. title.
Yes, that's what came out of the segment.
Yep.
Shane McMahon came out because Styles and Jericho both were saying they were owed their U.S. title rematch.
Hot off the heels of his helicopter crash, Shane McMahon just, hey, guys.
Hey, what's up? I'm good.
That helicopter didn't do nothing.
He turned out a lot better than Ric Flair did. But
that was a plane. I mean, he broke his back. Didn't a guy die in that crash? One guy died. Way to go, Michael.
What?
Just killed the
fucking heart and soul. Just saying, he did turn out a lot better.
It's
to the point where a triple threat match was made for the U.S. title in the main event that evening between Kevin Owens, AJ Styles, and Y2J, Travis.
Yeah.
Who won this match?
Well, that was the main event. We'll save that till the end.
I'm sorry.
Fancy pants this week. We'll go in order. Well, there's something I also want to get your thoughts on. I don't know if you saw the match this week. Baron Corbin, Shinsuke had a rematch this week.
Yes. Why wasn't that?
What was this on fucking Battleground?
Exactly.
What was this? This was good.
Yes.
Battleground was a waste of fucking time.
Yes.
Dick kick.
Yeah.
Ding, ding. Here's a clean finish. Yes.
Corbin, did they think less people were going to see this?
The only thing, yes, people like our buddy Tonk saw in Graphics, and he said, do this in a way he wanted to see, and we fantasy booked that over on a guest spot, but where neither man looked strong. Yes, Corbin ate the pin, but.
He looks strong.
And he's got the briefcase. Those guys always eat pens. It's kind of what they do. And that's sad, but that's how they've made it. But I don't think Corbin's hurt. All he's got to do is snap his fingers. He's in a title picture. And they could look at Jinder Mahal. Nobody's truly hurt if they don't want him to be.
Cut your goddamn hair.
Besides,
your hairline is farther back than fucking our grandfather's hairline. And you still have long hair.
Where are the cameramen?
When's it going to come to he's Paul Heyman?
The cameramen during every Shinsuke match, they just gonna
dodge it.
I'm good. Well, I want to get your thoughts on this too. I don't care. We talk about his hairline every fucking week. I want to talk about something else though.
It used to be his belly.
This is just as irritating for me. It seems like ever since Shinsuke has come on the main roster, they just can't get the camera angle right on the Kinshasa. They just don't shoot it right. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Is that fucking hard?
Why do they have to switch camera angles every time he does it?
Yes.
As soon as he's coming in, as soon as he comes in, let's do a camera switch so that it looks like it hit him. But it still looks terrible. It shouldn't seem terrible. Like
the good cameraman on NXT and the shitty ones are on there.
God. It's like, let's shoot to the guy out in the middle of the fucking crowd for that.
Yeah.
Like, they have the great shot, and then he goes to do the Kinshasa, and then they shoot to the guy out in the middle of the crowd. Yeah. Like, they might as well just shoot to crowd.
Yeah.
Like people going, oh!
At least you don't see how shitty it looks when you actually get it on fuck. But other than that, I got no complaints about this match. It didn't set my world on fire. You know, it's becoming my favorite quote, but it's okay.
I'm just angry that Baron Corbin's going to be the WWE champion at some point.
Well, this isn't going to make any... We'll talk about Shinsuke later, definitely. So that's why I'll move on to this.
Especially that hairstyle.
Your favorite part of any show right now, the Feel the Glow Championship, Michael. Backstage vignette. The
Light Bright Belt.
Naomi.
The Light Bright Belt, let's say it.
Is what it is, man. Can we go ahead and also say that the only reason this belt exists is to sell toys at this point? Christmas time's around the corner, kids. Get your shiny fucking women's SmackDown belt.
For $180.
This was Natalya being interrupted by Naomi in a promo backstage. And nothing
expected. Natalya and Naomi.
Jacqueline Light and the Queen of Charisma.
Fucking Natalya and Naomi in a promo battle. That's like watching fucking...
I mean, you did just say Natty was maybe one of your favorites in the whole company, but in this
ring.
Is how they're...
In ring!
Okay.
Not when she gets to speak.
Is it time to stop rocking the 1999 Chris Jericho haircut, too?
Yeah. Something, it really is.
Is it?
Like, I'm sure Tyson Kidd likes it.
Yeah.
But, Jesus Christ, Natty.
We already talked on the Battleground show, because quite honestly, I don't want to talk
about... She's the only one that can make Naomi look good on the microphone. To be honest with you, other than Tamina.
Let's round it off with the ladies this week on SmackDown with Charlotte and Becky Lynch tag team match against Tamina and Lana. This match was sloppy.
Why,
Michael? Why?
Answer. No fucking reason. Yeah. This isn't going to lead to anything.
Just something for them to do. Here's something maybe a little more interesting. A few of our mid-card favorites on SmackDown on one match. Sami Zayn, Ty Dillinger tag match against Mike Kanellis and Aiden English. Well, I thought they were your favorites. Michael, you may disagree.
The worst thing they're doing on SmackDown right now.
Just filler with these guys?
No. The fact that they're crushing Mike Kanellis already.
To guys like Sami Zayn and Dillinger.
Well, nothing that it's... I told you that I am a Ty Dillinger fan. I could see him as a world champion down the line, but a guy that's come in with the prestige of... Mike Kanellis, a.k.a. Mike Bennett.
Is it prestige with Mike Bennett, or is he just a fucking ROH guy that signed up?
I think if you're... Well, why did they bring him up to the main roster to start from then?
His wife.
If he's just going to lose.
His wife knows.
I mean, they're trying to sell this guy and his gimmick with his wife.
Yeah.
But they give him one match win.
You think he's got a lot of heat backstage with the boys? Especially guys that had to go through NXT just because... Does he come off like...
I don't think it matters.
Like a Mark Marrow?
I don't think it matters, but... If you're going to not put a guy in NXT like you did with him,
you gotta do something.
I think he should definitely go over on a guy that went through NXT.
It's like he beat Sami Zayn.
Beating Aiden English every week.
He beat Zayn his first match. And other than that, even in this tag match, Zayn keeps being the one to beat him. So
I mean, I love Sami Zayn. We think Sami Zayn should get a push. But with Mike Bennett, we're gonna call... Can we just call him Bennett?
Whatever you want.
Okay. I'm going to call him Mike
Bennett. They're doing whatever they want with his career right now, so you might as well call him whatever you want.
That's his fucking name. I'm calling him Mike Bennett.
There you go.
And with Mike Bennett, they're trying to... I just don't understand where creative... Who's in these meetings?
Can we say he looks better in the all-white attire, though?
I don't give a shit what he's wearing. I don't. Sorry. I don't give a shit what he's wearing. I give a shit about how he's being booked. If you're going to make
this... Perception's reality, though.
Well, usually in... As far as WWE goes in their track record, if somebody doesn't have to go through NXT, they're a top guy. AJ Styles didn't have to go through NXT.
Yeah.
So why are they losing to fucking Sami Zayn?
I don't know.
Or Ty Dillinger. He actually took the pin from Ty Dillinger, I believe.
Maybe they felt the SmackDown.
He took the pin from Ty Dillinger, I think.
No, he took it from Sami Zayn.
Did he?
I literally just watched it too because I don't remember what happened.
It's
I will say the crowd was red hot for this, and I didn't hate Dillinger and Zayn as a tag team, as a thrown together team. I thought they had good chemistry. And you know what? This is a good match. Can I call an underdog in this, by the way, out of all four of these guys?
In English.
As a breakout star in the future, possibly.
I love his tights.
You would. I do.
Aiden English, your breakout star?
Do his tights make him this week's thinner of the week?
Does he make him a doll baby?
It doesn't make him a doll baby. Who is this week's sinner of the week? I feel like that needs to be birthed here.
I didn't know that was being birthed this week. But if
some of the best things are organic, as we always say.
A sinner. That's,
and you got to do it how you say it when you do it each week, too. If we're going to do this officially.
The sinner of the week.
Who is it? It's going to be Paige every week. Let's say it until...
The sinner of the week goes to somebody that's not even in WWE. The sinner of the week goes to John Jones. Johnny Bones Jones.
Hot, good. Last night, it is hot. We might as well talk about it.
Yes, UFC 214 was live last night. In case you missed it, it was the biggest card of the year as far as the UFC goes. For those who don't know, in my content, I will be doing UFC reviews because they're not done on this channel, and I feel like it would be a good branch out for me to do my own thing with UFC because I know there's a lot of UFC fans out there. But last night was UFC 214. The main event was defending light heavyweight champion Daniel Cormier going against the only guy he's ever lost to in Johnny Bones Jones, who has been out for over 2 years.
Come back.
Doing
Adderall.
Yeah. Well,
been doing Adderall for 2 years.
Also, he blamed his last failed test on dick medicine. On Viagra, basically. But... that's why Johnny Jones was suspended for 2 years, basically. But he came back in his return against Daniel Cormier for the belt and knocked out Cormier in the third round with a head kick and follow-up punches to finish the bout. Johnny Bones Jones, after the fight, after he's been crowned the champion, said, I quote, Brock Lesnar. If you want to know what it feels like to get your ass kicked by somebody 40 pounds less than you, come meet me in the octagon.
And they're off. And as soon as he said that, the gates of fucking news hell unleashed on social media.
There's already betting odds on it.
A lot of people saying Brock, you know, it was like...
Brock Lesnar's the underdog in the betting odds, by the way.
2 weeks before Jones did this, it's been like considered a bargaining chip. Is Brock going to stay or go? But then this happened.
Well, we already saw in the news this week that Brock Lesnar has opted to not re-sign with WWE after WrestleMania 34. That's in the news. And I think that will be to set up this fight with Jon Jones at some point in 2018. My biggest issue with this is Brock Lesnar has been put as the underdog in this fight. Brock Lesnar will make the 265-pound weight limit. This will be a heavyweight fight. I don't care how good John Jones is. I watched the fight last night with him and Cormier. I feel like he looked like a shell of himself from a couple years previous.
Yeah.
John Jones looked like a dominant force 4 years ago. Last night, he knocked out the champion, which is hard to understate, but I still felt like skills-wise, he did not look like himself. And against a guy as big as Brock Lesnar, you can stop Daniel Cormier, who's fighting at the same weight as you. But if you're going up a weight class to fight a guy who's going to be right at 265 pounds until...
You need to be at your prime.
That's the day before the fight. The day of the fight, Brock Lesnar is going to be at least 280 pounds.
Yeah.
I would love to see you stop Brock Lesnar from taking you down to the ground and beating you to a fucking bubble. If I was betting, I will be in Vegas in 2 weeks. I am definitely going to put some money on the proposed fight.
Expect some video, guys, on the show here.
You will
up.
See me going.
It is happening. Mike's trip to Vegas. Vegas vacation. Chevy Chase going to be there. Newton.
He will not. But you will see me in 2 weeks going up to the betting window and betting on Brock Lesnar in that match. So
you'll probably see Blue Man Group. And have a bunch
I'm
eat.
Sorry, it's the eye test for me. I know how great Jon Jones is, and he could. And Daniel Cormier was an Olympic wrestler, but it's Greco wrestling, and Daniel Cormier was at 205, not at 265.
Yeah.
So there's a difference.
Right.
I'm sorry. I think Brock Lesnar will lay on top of him. and beat the shit out of him.
Whichever way it goes, they're going to make a lot of money off that fight, and I think Brock knows that.
Well, yeah, that's why. I think he decided. The wind's
blowing right now.
I think him and Jones actually collaborated on this, because before this, it was all of a sudden these two didn't like each other until Jones was coming back, and there was heat on the internet between two the
two. Instances like this, and with perfect coincidence, make you think the fix is in. And
yeah, well, not the fix is in, but I feel like the fight was coordinated between two guys. Right. Like, we could make a lot of money if we fought each other.
Right.
Like, we respect each other, but I feel like it's.
Same. I mean, they booked.
I feel like the same thing's going. Feel like the same thing's going on with Floyd Mayweather and Conor McGregor.
Right. Oh, that's totally.
I feel like these two guys love each other in real life, but they're doing whatever they can do to make money. I feel like after this fight is over and Conor McGregor loses, it's going. I don't even think it's going to be close. I feel like Floyd Mayweather. It's a boxing match.
It's catered for
Mayweather. Floyd Mayweather is going to win. I feel like after it's over, it's going to be. We never had a problem with each other. You know, we've always had respect, and everybody's like, well, why the fuck did I buy it then?
Yeah.
So it's, you know, it's basically what Jon Jones and Brock Lesnar are doing, except not as elaborate and not as long-winded.
Also, speaking of MMA and pro wrestling world mixing, and big news this week too, Cyborg.
Chris Cyborg.
Becky Lynch.
Going to the women's division.
Oh, why don't you get that MMA belt?
Chris Cyborg actually came out after her UFC win last night as well for the women's featherweight belt, came out and said afterwards that she wants Becky Lynch in a WWE ring.
On the same show. SummerSlam. Multiple WWE talent being called out.
SummerSlam, though. This is
this has been in talks for a while, and these two actually are.
She actually said it. Yeah. She wants her at SummerSlam. I'm wondering how much Cyborg's going to make for this, because you know Cyborg's going over.
Becky Lynch's spouse is in, who's her, he's an MMA guy too, I just can't remember the fighter.
He's not anybody worth talking about.
But she does have a background in it. It'll be a worked match. They're not going to have a legit shoot match in WWE. I don't know if they can. They can't do that.
Cyborg would kill her.
It's not 98, it's not the Brawl for All.
Have you ever seen Chris Cyborg?
Yes, and Becky Lynch would get her fucking ass kicked.
There's a legitimate shoot fighter, and then there's... Becky Lynch.
I will whore your channel out right here. That's just a sample of what you can find on your channel with your MMA stuff. If you guys are into that stuff, definitely Mike knows the shit on that. I look forward to helping you with that in the future. Michael, let's get to, speaking of who's going to win what, let's bring it back to SmackDown this week with pro wrestling. The biggest news coming out this week's show, Jinder Mahal had an in-ring celebration after,
the Maharaja.
You're going to love this. You're going to get a kick out of this. I said this on Kayfabe Today yesterday. Thank God for the kids, because my daughter... She made a comment calling it the pajama prison because she said it wrong. So I've looked at it.
Call it the poontag prison.
Well, that's night and day of how I... I don't know.
I'm not a child.
It made me see it in a funny way, like the ring was surrounded by bed sheets. And it was supposed to be brutal.
Could you imagine, like, SpongeBob, like, fucking pajamas?
There was the pajama prison, like, the loser had to strip pajamas off his opponent. And, like, fucking men on the... There was, like, layers of men. Yeah. But anyway, you know, that was funny. I thought I saw it for the show this week.
Only if they had the feet.
Interrupted by John fucking Cena. Michael, take it.
John Cena comes out and challenges Jinder Mahal basically to a match which everybody kind of predicted. But the only curveball that was thrown was...
I like this.
Shinsuke.
Well, Daniel Bryan came out.
Yes.
I like this line. He said, I don't know.
You have to earn your opportunities.
I make the matches. Yes. I make the match. I like that line. It made Cena kind of look like a prick. And when he announced it with Shinsuke, they shot to Cena's face and he looked worried. We don't see that a lot out of Cena. I like that. Now, the elephant in the room. I put up a poll on Twitter this week for the show. I put for the SlampX podcast this week. Do you feel that this was a waste of a potential big money match on pay-per-view by doing this at SmackDown? You guys overwhelmingly voted yes, like 70% or 80% yes. It was stacked. But
I think we all know how it's going to get booked. It's going to be a schmoz.
What's your answer to that?
It's going to be a schmoz. There's going to be no finish to this match. It's going to lead to a triple threat.
But do you think this was a waste to do on SmackDown, or do you think it's because my opinion?
I voted on it and I said yes, this was a waste of a big pay per view match.
But it's pay per view.
But I feel like as long as there's no finish next week on SmackDown, this will not hurt either guy. I feel like you still have the juice left for a later. Don't ever say that again. I hate Juventud Guerrero. But
you hate Juventud Guerrero.
I've said it many times on this show. Yeah, Well, not even that, but I feel like he had no in-ring psychology. But I feel like he's what's wrong with the cruiserweight division.
And he started
ushered it. In this boneheaded.
Yes.
There you go.
No psychology bullshit.
He's not the greatest person outside of the ring, as we've heard in but numerous stories.
Still, as long as this is a schmoz, I feel like we're going to be fine.
Jesus, Michael. Fucking indigestion. Let's take some antacid next week. 76.
I really should.
Yeah, you know what? I the other reason I say it's not, I would say in any other era, fuck yes. If this was 98, hell yeah. But pay-per-view, their money is on Raw and SmackDown now. They got your money on the network. Like, pay-per-view isn't what it was. It's financially, it's just not.
I mean, that's why you have the network.
And they're going to have rematches, like you said, anyway. So I don't see why people... It's just something for people to complain about, I guess. But I just wanted to get everyone's thoughts on it. Thank you guys for voting.
If there's a clean finish in this match, I will be very, very surprised.
We have a problem then with
and
it?
I will have a problem.
We'll
yes.
see. And I will have a problem.
And I will talk about it next week if there is a clean finish in this match.
My favorite part of SmackDown this week, because right before the main event, was actually not Cena, not any of these guys. It was the New Day getting attacked during Big E's intro by the Usos, getting the shit laid out of them. It shocked me.
Loved it.
Me too. It shocked me. We've never seen this done. They had never thought about doing this before. They've never done this where they attacked Big E during. And it was came off tremendous. My favorite part of SmackDown this week. Usos are killing it for me.
I loved it.
Usos and the New Day right now. I'm still great with them, with New Day having those belts for now, as long as it's not another dominant run. But those new belts need credibility.
Yeah.
And what better team? I mean, these are the two best teams. I didn't see a problem
with the Usos carrying it, but if they're going to continue the feud, there had to be a little more back and forth.
Incentive. Yes. Something.
Yes.
You like this segment too? Awesome. Because I thought you might not like it.
That's no, great. I did like it. It was something different, which I always like if it's placed correctly.
Yeah. Made sense.
I felt like it was placed correctly because we were always used to Big E getting his, wherever we're at, you know.
And mixing it up.
Yeah. That'll be my thing on the chat this evening. Oh, wherever we are. But it was done. I don't know who came up with this idea in the creative department, but they hit it out of the park with me.
There you go. A lot of people saying Road Dogg pulls a lot of the strings.
Well, he writes SmackDown. He's a lead writer on SmackDown.
Could have been him.
But I felt like this was done correctly. It needed to be done, especially after they just won the belts.
Yeah.
The New Day won the belts, and the Usos won them back. This is telling a good story, a physical story, because they put on a fucking classic at the Battleground pay-per-view. It was the match of the night for me.
By the way, I said this on Kayfabe Today yesterday. I want to tell it to you because you were there for the when I didn't see the match because I was driving center, whatever you want to call me. I went back and I watched it like you suggested, and you described that super kick spot to me.
Yeah,
and I immediately compared it to Shelton Benjamin on the show because that's what I pictured going into. It was a good spot, but because I did that to myself, it didn't live up to the show.
Didn't look
spot.
As good.
But I didn't have a fair chance because you saw it first, I guess.
Yeah, if you'd have saw it live, it would have been like, oh.
And that's, I totally knew it. I was like, oh, that's good, but it could have been so much fucking better.
Because you hadn't seen it since then.
Exactly. That's exactly
why.
If
you were watching it live, you'd have been like, oh, you know what I mean?
Exactly. And I knew that as soon as I went back to watch it. I'm like, I'm probably going to disappoint myself, but that's what happens. Main event, SmackDown Live, United States title, Kevin Owens defending against AJ Styles and Chris Jericho. Fine match, nothing wrong with the match. The finish, we got another U.S. title champion, Michael. They are flip-flopping the hell out of this thing. What is this doing credibility-wise? Is it diminishing the title? Is it enhancing anyone in this feud right now? And where do you see this going? Because I would take all these guys out of the feud, maybe one final blow-off, just because you got nothing for Owens to do. And like some kind of spectacular, memorable match. Jericho and Owens SummerSlam, round two. And then Rusev and Styles, United States title SummerSlam. You disagree, but I'm interested to see what you want to do. Is that what you would do, though?
No.
What I just did?
I like what they're doing.
Well, the lights are burning out down here. One of the lights just went out.
Evidently, Jesus doesn't agree.
Fuck.
But I think the smart money is on Kevin Owens and Shane McMahon at SummerSlam because the blow-off of this match, I think you saw the start to, it's a big pay-per-view. You're going to have Shane McMahon in it, probably. The smart money is him and Kevin Owens.
Yep, that's on the dirt sheets.
I could see AJ Styles and Rusev, to be honest with you. But it doesn't make sense to me considering Rusev has only been in one match since he's come back and he's lost to John Cena. So why magically is he in the U.S. title picture when he hasn't won a fucking match?
Well,
so unless they build him strong going into SummerSlam, if there's some kind of
U.S. title tournament bullshit where Kevin Owens is left out because Shane McMahon doesn't like him.
Tournament. I'd like to see a tournament.
I would love to see it to where Kevin Owens is left out because Shane McMahon's pissed at him, which would lead to their feud.
Perfect.
And also, you have a contender for AJ Styles. I would like to see this feud blow off with AJ Styles and Kevin Owens. I feel like it's been overdone.
WWE creative guys, if you're listening to the show,
I've said it before.
It's not fucking hard.
I've said it before. Just listen to me. I will book you to the moon.
But I mean, AJ Styles. Did you like the finish of him being the champion again?
I could see. I could see because they have enough guys on SmackDown that they're booking. I could see at least a 4-man tournament for the number one contender.
Yeah, I know you want Kanellis in there. Say it.
Well, you got to have Kanellis in there. You have Sami Zayn.
Yes.
You have
Dylan Ty.
You have Ty Dillinger and you have Rusev. That would be my 4 guys.
I would bring that down to Ty with the Savio Vega underdog getting all these wins leading to Rusev. But Rusev's his brick wall. And that's a good way to get Ty over.
You have Ty Dillinger. Or Zayn. You have Ty Dillinger beat Mike Kanellis. And you have Rusev beat Sami Zayn.
I mean, God forbid Mike Kanellis eat another pin, Michael.
Yeah,
easy. You just booked him.
But if you're going to book it like that, that's how you book it. But the way I would book it, honestly, would be Sami Zayn and Rusev in the finals of that.
Yeah.
I would have my, I would,
Rusev still winning.
Yes.
The tournament.
I would have Ty Dillinger against Rusev in the semis, and I would have Kanellis and Sami Zayn in the other semi.
Yeah.
But that's how I would book it for the number one contender at SummerSlam.
Yes,
for that
WWE, you need a tournament. It's time. I feel like
we don't have to take the ring. They're already doing the Mae Young Classic thing, but I would still do something on television.
Yeah.
You could do it all in one night if you wanted to do it.
I'm going to say it now. This is going to make me sound like a shout out to Slam Tits, Kristen. I don't think the Mae Young Classic is going to get over as much.
No, it's not.
Just because people were too pig-headed to give him a chance because it's women. I'll give it a chance.
Well, I don't think it's because of that.
I think it's a poor reason, though, because people associate there's so many years of bad women's wrestling. It's hard to get that taste.
I don't think it has anything to do with the pig-headedness. I think it has to do with...
Spoilers.
Does anybody really
know... Don't make me say it this week.
How many women in that tournament do you know?
A couple. Handful. Exactly. But I didn't know a lot of the CWC guys either.
You did know at least half of them.
Yeah, that is true. The UK, guys, I knew, like, one. I knew, and I liked that tournament better than the CWC.
But that was all in one night.
Yeah. We'll see. I'm sure it's going to be fine.
That's my problem. Nobody knows these women in this tournament. That's the biggest problem.
You have Candice LeRae. You have Jade from TNA. You have Serena Deeb. I'm just thinking of the memorable ones I know.
You can get a handful of people that you know. And
you have Bridget Nielsen from Rocky IV in there. Did you see her?
Yeah.
See that?
Why is she wrestling?
Why are some of these women...
Isn't she like 60?
Why are some of these women in this tournament and Tamina's on SmackDown?
It's just what I'm saying.
If
you had more people that you recognize in this tournament, it would get those people that aren't recognized.
Are you
going to
check it out, though? You still have
no,
the network.
Probably
you're
not
going to check it out? What is it about it that you're not going to... Why you're going to not...
Well, Leva Bates isn't in for one.
Well, biased aside.
But
as you're doing your job as a broadcast journalist.
But like I said, my problem is there's not enough recognizable talent in this tournament for me to watch. I didn't watch the UK tournament,
to
be honest with you.
And that's exactly what 205 Live needs, in your opinion, too. And I think I agree with that because 205 Live has been floundering, but this is fresh out the gate.
Because I am your stereotypical WWE fan. The more recognizable talent you have in your tournament.
Molly Holly. Bring her back.
Like they did with the Cruiserweight
She'll
Classic.
She'll be fine.
You had people like Tajiri in it. And you're like, all right,
we
fuck.
Were so happy to see Tajiri.
Yeah, I mean, to be honest with you. And then you had Brian Kendrick. People like that.
Yeah.
It made it more watchable for me because that made those other guys that I didn't know go, holy shit, who is this guy? So if you had more recognizable talent, maybe if you took some of the women like Victoria or Ivory or people like that, that maybe could still work a match or two and put them in that tournament.
Yeah.
It's taking a spot or two away from these people you don't know, but still.
BB,
it's going
from
to,
the Attitude Era.
Yes, it's still going.
Oh, you want to see her back.
Well, no, I'm just saying it's going to make you want to watch the tournament more.
Yeah.
For those
because
fans,
for the more casual
for those
fan.
Fans that
because you get
yes,
overwhelmed from
exactly.
like if someone would come to you with like the current PWG roster,
yes.
You would be blown. You'd be like, I don't know any of these.
Yeah, it's to that point with me.
Yeah.
So as the casual
or Lucha Underground, roster.
I'm not a casual WWE fan. I'm an avid fan, but as far as everything else goes, I'm casual.
Yeah.
So if you had more recognizable talent, fucking bring Lita out of retirement to wrestle one match. You're telling me her neck can't handle one match?
She wouldn't do that to her best friend, Trish, though.
I'm just saying, more recognizable talent would make this tournament go over better.
Yeah.
Especially to the casual audience that's already like, women's wrestling. So that's my opinion on it. Let me know if you think I'm a pighead or a fucking idiot down below in the comment section. But that's how I feel.
I'm sure you won't be on any. I'm sure we're going to have some kind of coverage of that, some show for the Mae Young Classic.
I may watch some of it, but I'm not interested to watch it, to be honest
with you. For at least like the first couple episodes, maybe we'll have a show or something.
I have no interest in watching it, but I may watch it anyway.
Hopefully it's good. But Michael, that was SmackDown Live this week. What do you give overall this week's episode? Did it surpass Raw? You said you're saving this to the end. What was the better show?
It did not.
Monday Night Raw, in your opinion.
I thought Raw was a better show.
They're just disagree until the
bitter end. I like the angle. I love the opening segment. It was one of the best opening segments I've seen in recent weeks on Raw, with the Fatal 4-Way being... I thought they handled that perfectly.
Yeah.
They made Braun Strowman look great.
Joe looked strong.
Yes, they made... Raw. Yes. And I liked the Sasha Banks-Bailey match, of course. Also, there were some other things I liked on Raw, but... I didn't care. There was the low points for me probably would have to be the Elias Sampson.
The Sonic Pretzel Dog commercial with Bailey.
That wasn't very good. But I liked the Good Brothers turning face. Even though they ate the pin from the Revival. I liked it. But there was some good stuff on Raw. I felt like it flowed better for me. So Raw won my war this week. As far as it goes, I gave Raw a B-. I gave SmackDown a C+ at a very... This is probably one of the closest battles I've ever seen
from the
two shows.
Neither one was a really great show, in my opinion, but by
they're both decent.
By a Japanese cut and hair, just because of the Nakamura-Corbin match, I think, for me, believe it or not, SmackDown was better. Because it was refreshing, because I thought they were going to shit the bed again and have another DQ finish. No, it was actually the match I won in the Battleground. That was good to see. I thought the Cena stuff was fine. I'm enjoying Gender.
That ruined it for me.
I'm still enjoying Gender, so get out of here with that.
I hate it.
He's coming off like a guy in Punch-Out, like that fucking guy in
the character. This is why you have 20 people showing up to their live events, to be honest with you. You make a guy that hasn't won a match in 2 years your champion, and then build him as your strong champion. People are like, why the fuck would I go to their live show?
The Return of Jericho is a good one for me,
too. Yes, that was the shock value. But to me, People come at me. I don't buy into Gender. I'm never going to buy into Gender.
He's going to hinder that Gender
all day.
I'm sorry.
It's just not going to happen.
Singing his song about
I'm an avid fan. You can sell me. My problem is you sell me fucking shitty old potatoes and then try and make that old potato
look
like... They
got the ears on them sticking out and they're black
and they're
smushy.
Green and yucky.
Mushy.
And then you take that potato...
And they stink!
And they try to make it look like the best potato you ever had in your life. I'm not going to buy it.
There's some sour cream and butter on and be like, here, dinner.
It's,
you're not
going to
eat
the
it.
Biggest
I'm
problem.
The man that's going to take that bite and the potato doesn't
And people
taste
can
bad.
Say whatever they
the
want.
The Punjabi prison match made me go vomit. I had to step away from my potato, but I'm back at the table and I'm eating some more.
I didn't think it was terrible. I didn't think it was the worst Punjabi prison match ever.
Well, look at,
you only had two other comparisons, but my
the way out because
my
God
problem
knows
is
that
the booking.
Our review of it was cut out on YouTube. Pretty
I felt
much.
Like it was like, well, we have this big Indian audience. Let's make Jinder look strong. So to me, it reeks.
I gotta agree. That was the hardest decision I've had to. It's come down to the wire. Which show is better this week? Neither show was bad, I would say. They're doing better for now.
And I feel like Jinder is taking on that role of generic foreign heel, which really is not original to me, which makes me even shit on it more.
Oh, hello, PG.
Yeah, it just That's makes me there. Shit on it more. He looks like Sergeant Slaughter Light to me.
Oh,
that's what it looks like. At least Sergeant Slaughter poked fun at the Americans because it was a wartime.
Well, easy. There's Gender to levels, and then you go down to Ari Davari levels.
Well, I'm sorry. Sergeant Slaughter, that's who Gender reminds me of, except at a light level.
Gender reminds you of a white man, Bob Remus, Sergeant Slaughter in a turban.
Yeah.
You racist piece of shit.
Well, I'm sorry.
I'm just kidding.
I mean, Sergeant Slaughter did more for me as a heel than Gender does.
Oh, I agree with that. I agree with that, too. Look at the angle Slaughter had to work with, though. You know what I mean?
Well, it was during wartime, which made it even better, but...
Imagine if there's war now. Would they do that?
Well, a war with India? Do you really think anybody in this country would actually take notice to that? They have 1.3 billion people, and we're going to kill them all. So that's basically...
And that would be the babyface promo.
Yeah.
The mentality in this
country. That'd be John Cena.
Jesus Christ. Jesus. On that note, Michael, this has been Slam Picks Podcast number 75.
We still have news and rumors.
I thought we snuck in all
There's other
news stuff
we didn't get in.
Oh, come on. We're at the end of the road, like boys to men.
No. They had...
You're
sending
all over the place.
Go ahead.
Right
go ahead. It, I can do it if you want. If you want to throw it to me.
Well, let's go pop into the news. Let's get it in there.
It's time for this week's news and rumors.
There you have it. Michael, what's popping in the tiddlywinks?
The tiddlywinks this week. WWE had the final show ever. Boston. At the Joe Louis Arena.
Oh, at the Joe Louis. I thought I was going to say
in,
the God.
I believe that's in Detroit.
Yes.
Yes.
Jim Louis Arena. What a place.
Joe Louis.
Oh, Joe Louis?
Yeah. Sorry, Bobby.
But notoriously, obviously, Survivor Series 91.
It was a SmackDown show, but was headlined by the Universal Championship match between Samoa Joe challenging, Brock Lesnar. This was how they sent out the Joe. They said, actually, Kevin Owens got the biggest reaction out of anybody.
There you have it.
For some reason. But the show did not feature any title changes, anything like that. It was the
standard
final
house show.
It was the final show ever at the Joe Louis Arena. There will not be
anything. But a big house show.
Yes, it will not. There will not be anything else at that arena ever.
Well, a lot of history in that building, Michael.
So
been there for a while.
Also in the news,
sad to see it go.
On a little bit of a downer, brother of Dolph Ziggler.
Yes.
Gets convicted.
Michael, what were the charges? They weren't good. They were not good. Let me get my my Googler out here, because I did not plan on doing
it. It was a Cleveland hotel shooting.
There you go.
Dolph Ziggler's brother, Donald Nemeth, pled guilty Friday on involuntary manslaughter, aggravated robbery, and other charges in the January 2016 shooting death of Joshua Maskell during a drug deal inside a Cleveland hotel. So this is not a good look for Dolph Ziggler. I guess maybe this is why in the past year or so we haven't seen much from him.
Well, his brother was an up-and-coming wrestler, too. He looked just like fucking Dolph Ziggler facially. You could tell they were brothers. Yeah, I'm looking at it right here, too, of mine. He looked like he was a young kid. He was in good shape. He looked like he had a potential, but this is a sad case, and obviously our thoughts
Donald Nemeth, he's 30 years old. He's my age.
You know, so we joke around with Ziggler as his own air persona, but in all seriousness, our thoughts go out to Ziggler and his family. That sucks. That's sad. Because it looked like I said, the kid had a lot of potential, and you hate to see that squandered with dumb choices. Hopefully he learns from his mistakes, Michael. Turns it around.
Hopefully. But he's going to be going to prison for a little bit. So
just to try to get that little thought.
I feel bad for Dolph Ziggler, because like you, Travis, you are my brother.
It would definitely,
Dolph Ziggler has a brother, and I can only imagine what it would do to me if you were convicted of that. It may affect my everyday life.
It definitely explains why he's been off the air lately, and why they've given him some personal time. So, best wishes to
Dolph. I hope you get through this the best way you can. As far as me going from brother to brother, Travis, please don't ever do that to me, and I will never do it to you.
I'll try not to go convicted armed robbery.
I'll try not to go kill somebody in a drug deal if you don't.
All right.
So
there it is.
Yeah. So
with that, on that note,
yeah,
convicted nice drug note. Deals and Michael number 75 is in the books.
Hey, go fuck yourself.
Until then, Michael, one more time, where can everyone check you out on Twitter and all that good shit?
You can check me out at Mike the Slam Pig. As always, check out our sister show, The Reset Button. Always check out the Cruise Control Show. As always, Travis, we are the most what?
We're the most interactive pro wrestling podcast on the internet. And follow me, The Hibiki TMD, on Twitter at The Hibiki TMD. Check me out on Grapple Listen. Kayfabe Today podcast on First Thing Morning YouTube. Get over there, like and subscribe. Slam Pig's Cruise Control. Yeah. That's it. Also, game reviews. I've been meaning to get more gaming back on the channel, so it's good to see it's making its way back. Well, some Let's Plays. And until then, man, thank you for another
bring
week.
Bring that up on the show.
Gaming?
Yeah. The reset button. You got that. That's all you get.
Until
it's a wrestling podcast.
I cannot wait for this trivia show. You've got me so ready
for it.
To destroy you.
You get to pick the topic, because I'm going to be the champion, but I have to have a one-day...
Notice. Oh, what is this one-day notice?
The way JB does it.
Okay, all right. Not how I'd run things, but I'm not going
to
complain.
That's fine. The challenger has to give the champion a one-day notice.
And I'm digging the post-edit
city. Even if it's not a rule right now, it will be a rule when I'm the champion.
Oh, we'll see. Until next week, maybe we'll have a guest. Who knows? I doubt we go live, like you said.
Yeah, we're not going live till SummerSlam.
It was good to do this old school style. Once again, next week, Michael. Until then, Slam Picks Podcast.
Art! Hey, you dirty fucking pigs. Mike here from the Slam Pigs Podcast, reminding you once again to check us out on Twitter, whether it be the Slam Picks podcast, whether it be me at Mike the Slam Pick, or whether it be our sister show, The Reset Button. Check us out. Also, you can find us on Facebook at the Slam Picks podcast or The Reset Button. And as always, make sure you check us out as a whole on Hibiki, TMD. Until we see you next time, oink oink.